everyone, and welcome to the American Society for Microbiology and the Elizabeth O. King Lecture. My name is Marina Moses, and I'm the director of the American Academy of Microbiology. That's the honorific arm of ASM. It's my pleasure this evening to introduce you to the Elizabeth O. King Lecturer. I'll be introducing our honored guest, Dr. Michael Diamond. This annual lecture series is made possible through the funding from the Trust of Audrey Rhinestone. This lecture is a collaborative effort between the American Academy of Microbiology and ASM Communications, and their speaker series, Microbes After Hours. So after this presentation, we will be having a reception in the rooms as you enter. This year, we are particularly pleased to host this particular lecture in collaboration with the American Society of Virology as well. This latter collaboration came to being under past president Grant McFadden, and we look forward to our continued collaborations with the new president, Becky Dutch. Our event this evening is being live streamed, so in addition to the audience in the room, the online viewers, along with all of you present, will have the opportunity to ask questions after Dr. Diamond's lecture. We invite the people watching on the web to send in their questions to Dr. Diamond through the YouTube chat room or through Twitter using the hashtag ASMLive. For those of you in the room, we have a microphone in the back. And after the presentation concludes, we ask that you stand there and ask your question. This presentation will also be archived and available in the future on ASM's YouTube channel. In addition, we're going to be tweeting throughout the presentation. So Elizabeth O. King was a clinical microbiologist who worked for the CDC. She had a particular interest in meningitis that affected pediatric patients. In 1959, she isolated a novel microbe while she was working on unclassified bacteria associated with meningitis in infants. This organism causes meningitis and also less commonly causes pneumonia and sepsis, bloodstream infections, and meningitis in both immunocompromised adults and infants. In later years, she also identified another pathogen that was causing another outbreak. This particular outbreak was associated with systemic bone and joint infections and spread through childcare centers. Both of these pathogens were named after her in her honor. In the same spirit, our Board of Governors, the American Academy of Microbiology, every year selects a lecturer who embodies her interest, the O. King's interest, in investigative research. And this year, we're very honored to say that the BOG, our Board of Governors, selected Dr. Diamond. Dr. Diamond's talk is entitled Understanding the Pathogenesis of the Emerging Zika Virus. So a little bit about him before he gets up here. He is a professor in the departments of medicine, molecular, microbiology, pathology, and immunology, and the associate director of the Center for Human Immunology and Immunotherapy Programs at Washington University School of Medicine. He received his MD and PhD from Harvard Medical School and Harvard University. He completed his postdoctoral training at the University of California, Berkeley, and his internship, residency, and fellowship in infectious diseases at the University of California, San Francisco. He is an elected fellow of the American Academy of Microbiology, which we're very pleased about, the Association of American Physicians, and the American Society of Clinical Investigation. The Diamond Lab investigates mechanisms of pathogenesis of emerging viruses of global concern. Novel interdisciplinary approaches are used to explore the interface between the virus and host, with particular interest in understanding cell and tissue-specific antiviral immune responses, especially in the brain. So please join me right now in welcoming Dr. Diamond to the podium.
Thank you very much for that generous introduction. It seems as if the for those who are not here, the rain has ceased, which is, I think, a good omen for the talk. In addition, the air conditioning has gone off, so I can actually hear myself for a little while. Today I'm going to talk about Zika virus. And I'm going to do so from two perspectives. The talk is going to be divided really in two halves. The first half is really to try to put a portrait on what has transpired over the past year to year and a half, where this virus has emerged from relative obscurity into one that is in the newspaper virtually every day in some form or another. And in the second half of the talk, I'm going to focus on how we in the laboratory, my laboratory, but also other groups worldwide are trying to make strides to understanding how this virus causes some unique clinical syndromes and how this can be translated into ways to control the virus, or at least figure out what are the exact diseases that it can and cannot cause, and who are the people at risk, and how this risk can be mitigated. So just to start, this is a picture of the Aedes aegypti mosquito, which is the primary vector, mosquito vector for Zika virus. It is also the primary mosquito vector for a number of other viruses of global concern, primarily dengue virus, chikungunya virus, and also yellow fever virus. So the same one mosquito can carry multiple different viruses, not necessarily at the same time, but in different places over space and time, and transmit many different viruses that cause problems for human global health. As we think about Zika virus, I think about it in the context of a slide that Tony Fauci's generated several years ago, and this is from a review from David Morin's, and Tony Fauci's the head of NIAID just across town. And in this slide, Tony depicts the types of pathogens that have started to emerge and reemerge. This is circa 2004. And you can see that there are a number of different pathogens, many of them viruses, and many of them bacteria, many of them multi-drug resistant bacteria, and then even other types of pathogens such as protozoa or other fungi. And here we have, in the United States at the time, West Nile virus was a significant concern as it spread through the continental United States, and it remains a concern. Every year there's endemic transmission with a few thousand cases, and it can vary based upon the ecological conditions, the climate, as well as the immune population, possibly in the birds, as well as in the mosquito population. However, it is not alone. We have many other viruses that cause diseases all over the world. And the point is that despite significant advances in understanding pathogens, despite significant advances in generating antibacterial agents that can mitigate disease and new vaccines every year, we still have a long way to go because pathogens come and go, and new ones emerge, and we can never really predict which ones are going to emerge when they do, unfortunately. And as they do, in some ways, we have to respond to it, and we are reactionary. The other way to figure it is to try to say, well, can we study all of these pathogens at once and develop pan-antivirals and pan-antibacterials? And these are areas, certainly, of significant research efforts to try to anticipate what might be coming and have plans for it. So let's focus on Zika virus. So Zika virus, as I alluded to, was obscure. Here's where it started in Africa. It was isolated in 1947 from a sentinel monkey that was in the canopy of the forest, in Zika forest in Uganda. And there was a scientist at the time who was trying to actually identify what they thought was an outbreak of yellow fever or some other virus, and he basically put some monkeys in the forest in cages and then allowed them to get sick or not get sick after they were exposed to certain types of insects, in this case mosquitoes, that were naturally in the forest. And he followed them over time, and one of them got sick on one day, and he took the blood of that monkey and then he put it into a mouse. And one particular monkey's blood, it was able to cause disease in a mouse, and he passaged that virus through the mouse, and eventually that virus became Zika virus. That first isolate was first published in 1952, and there was a few papers that were associated with it, and then there was not much done with it at the time. And that was because Zika virus didn't really cause significant disease in humans as far as they could tell here in Africa in the 1950s, And then later it spread into Asia in the 1960s, and it also moved back into Africa in the 1980s. But it was associated with a very mild clinical syndrome, which I'll talk about a little bit later, whereby people had a fever and it seemed to go away, and there was no known long-term repercussions of the disease. And then it was very quiet, and there was actually very little research being done on it. Somewhat appropriately, why would you study something that really didn't cause too much of a problem? And then in 2007, there was an outbreak in Yap Island. Now, Yap Island is not really a huge tourist destination. However, it was a destination for Zika virus. And here, approximately, I think it's about 60 to 70% of the population actually became infected. And while this certainly put it on the radar for public health concerns because such a high fraction of the population got infected, in fact, most of the people still got mild disease and it didn't really cause major illnesses. However, in 2013, it spread to Micronesia and French Polynesia, and here it again infected about 2/3 to 3/4 of the population. But at this point in time, there was an observation that there was an association with Guillain-Barré syndrome. Now, Guillain-Barré syndrome is a neurologic syndrome that can cause a sensory polyneuropathy that can actually progress towards paralysis and intensive care unit requirements, and people can rarely even die from it. And so this was the first incidence of when there was severe disease occurring associated with Zika virus. But again, it was seemed very restricted, and it was in a small population, again, on an island. However, of course, now we know that this virus then spread to Brazil, where it found abundant supplies of its mosquito vector, the Aedes aegypti vector, because there's a lot of dengue, which is transmitted by the same vector. And here, either something happened to the virus or the population, and I'll allude to this a little bit later, the virus then, within 1 year, rapidly spread through many parts of Brazil, also into other countries in South America, into Central America, to Puerto Rico, and up into Mexico. And so this virus rapidly spread within 1 year to about 40 different countries. Where is it going? So this is, of course, a major issue and a major concern for scientists, for public health people, but also for the average person who's concerned about the new clinical syndromes of Zika, which we'll talk about. As I alluded to, this year, moves all the way up. We're in the Caribbean as well. And now I have three red arrows here, which are certainly of major concern. We're in the press, we've heard a lot about the Olympics in Rio. We'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. Certainly this is a concern for athletes who have been training most of their lives for a few weeks period of time and really don't want to become sick with a potentially devastating illness or one that could affect a newborn becoming pregnant with unborn fetuses. And then we have two other ones here, which are where is the U.S. at risk, which I'll talk about, and we have Florida, and then we have the Gulf states here. And as you may be aware, this past week there have been reports of possible local transmission of Zika virus in Florida. It has not been confirmed, but in parts of southern Florida, they're now investigating whether there are cases of Zika that were not associated with travel or sexual transmission, which I'll again talk about. So let's just allude to where the problems are in the US. Do we have cases? Absolutely. And if you go on to the CDC website, you can follow this. This is now a couple of weeks old, but there were about 1,132 traveler cases as of July 11th. There were about 2,500 cases that were considered local in US territories, primarily in Puerto Rico. And there were about 600 pregnant women that were infected that were being followed to see what would be the outcome of Zika virus on their pregnancies. If we think about what are the areas at highest risk, the areas where the mosquitoes are. Of course, you can travel to a mosquito endemic area, either in the United States if it spreads to the United States, or more likely going to South America, Central America, or Brazil, where there may be high endemicity of the mosquito and the virus. However, the United States has Aedes aegypti mosquitoes, and really it's about in this range here, parts of Florida, through Mississippi, Louisiana, Texas, and a little bit north. And then there's a related mosquito called Aedes albopictus, which can transmit Zika virus as it can transmit dengue, but it is not nearly as efficient. And we don't know how much this mosquito is actually contributing to the current epidemic at this point in time. Those still being studied by the entomologists and the people who study vector biology, but most people feel that this one is the primary one, and therefore this area is the region that's going to be most at risk initially. So what about the Olympics? Should the Olympic athletes be concerned? Well, yes and no. There's no real great answer to this. What, of course, in Brazil they've said is they're certainly trying mosquito abatement programs, and I'll mention what those are momentarily. But here is one of the things that's actually can make you feel a little bit better, which is if you look at the mosquito peak season, and this is for Aedes aegypti and is also true for transmission of dengue, the season peaks earlier, somewhere between May and June, and then comes down in August when the mosquitoes are at a lower number, and then comes back up in the late fall through the winter in the southern hemisphere. So this is the point at which the Rio Olympics would be occurring in late August, or mid to late August, and you can see here that the number of mosquitoes are significantly down. Now, down does not mean gone, so of course minimizes the risk, but it doesn't eliminate the risk. So let's talk a little bit about the biology of Zika virus. Talk a little bit about its epidemiology, where it came from, what parts of the world it's infecting. In order to understand some of the laboratory approaches, we really need to sort of put it into the context of where it fits in virology. Being at ASM, at this institution here, we need to talk about it being a virus. And so this virus is a flavivirus. One that I work on in my laboratory, one that is very well studied by a number of investigators worldwide, become apparent in a moment. It is a 10 kilobase virus, approximately 10 to 11 kilobase virus, which means it has a relatively small genetic capital. It has only 3 structural genes and 7 non-structural genes. That's 10 genes compared to thousands that we have. It makes one protein and then it gets chopped up into its little constituent proteins. So this virus belongs to this family of viruses, and in this family are a number that cause human disease, like West Nile virus here in the US, Japanese encephalitis virus, which is closely related, dengue virus, Zika virus, yellow fever virus, and then another family called the tick-borne encephalitis viruses. And these are transmitted by mosquitoes, but also by ticks, depending on the individual virus. And they can cause many different clinical syndromes, ranging from encephalitis, like West Nile, shock syndrome, like dengue and yellow fever, and liver failure, which is where yellow fever got its name, because people were jaundiced. The virus is 50 nanometer in size, and the cryo-electron microscopy structure was recently solved this year by two groups, one at Purdue and one at Singapore, and it forms this icosahedral structure. It's about 50 nanometer in size, and it sort of looks like a golf ball. And while it creates pretty pictures, this information actually is extremely important in understanding how to target the virus, either by small molecule inhibitors or potentially by antibody-based therapeutics, or also trying to understand how vaccines can target this virus. So this is a key breakthrough that was published earlier this year by two groups. In the context of flaviviruses, dengue is the number one mosquito-transmitted virus in the world, hands down. 390 million infections a year, approximately 75 to 100 million cases per year worldwide, and a subset of these go on to severe hemorrhagic fever shock syndrome. Whereas the numbers for Zika are anticipated to be in the millions this year, probably a couple of million, although the numbers are still very loose. And for West Nile, as every year, as I alluded to, we expect that we have a couple of thousand cases, although it's now estimated that about 3 to 4 million Americans have been infected with West Nile since it came in 1999, although most of those have had minimal symptoms or mild disease. So Zika virus is related to the other flaviviruses. This is a dendrogram. This is what we use to try to understand relatedness to viruses, and this helps us understand what types of approaches might be used which could be conserved, meaning could you identify something that was antiviral or inhibitory against a related virus, and would it work against Zika? Or correspondingly, if you happen to make something against Zika, what would it do against the related viruses? And also, this information is actually quite useful for understanding evolution and where the viruses came from. And so Zika virus fits in over here, and it's very closely related to dengue. So at one point, there was some discussion of whether it could actually be a bona fide dengue virus. It's clearly not, but there was some discussion of it. But it is clearly closely related to dengue, but it is distinct, and the rest of the tree is here. There is what we call one serotype of Zika virus, meaning there is genetic variation. There are three lineages. There's an Asian, American, and African. They differ only by about 3 to 5% genetically. That means 3 to 5% of their amino acids are different. The rest of them are virtually identical to one another. And the serotype means that if somebody makes antibodies against one strain of Zika, likely they will be protected against another strain of Zika. Now, this has to be tested experimentally and empirically over time and space, but based on the genetic relatedness and some of the preliminary data that's actually coming out of laboratories, it seems that there really is only one serotype of Zika virus, and that if you, in theory, got infected or were vaccinated against one strain, you would be protected against the others as long as your immune response was maintained. So let's talk a little bit about the clinical syndromes of Zika virus, and this will dovetail in to how and what are the key questions that we need to answer experimentally in the laboratory. So first, let's talk about what happens in most of the cases, which is the minimal clinical syndrome. So 80% of the people do not develop any clinical syndrome that they know of, meaning they get bitten by a mosquito, they get a little bit of Zika virus into their either blood or skin, depending upon how the mosquito bites, and they don't have any symptoms whatsoever. And then there's another 20% that develop a mild febrile illness. And what happens is the mosquito bites, and then within a few days, the virus replicates, presumably in the lymph node or local tissues. It might replicate in the skin to some degree. In some target cells that still are being identified, you get virus that then gets into the bloodstream and then disseminates. This is the viremic phase. And this is the phase usually people begin to feel relatively lousy. They might have a fever, a headache, muscle aches, because if you have virus in your blood or if you have bacteria in your blood, it provokes an immune response, and that immune response provokes fever and also provokes many of the symptoms that are associated with a flu-like illness. And then at some point soon afterwards, your immune system kicks in and you begin to develop antibodies as well as other adaptive immune cells such as T cells, and these things are able to abort the viremia, control the virus, eliminate the virus from cells, and then ultimately the symptoms go away, and within 10 days or so, the people who had symptoms don't have any further symptoms, and essentially it's done. That's for most of the people. There are some caveats to this which will become apparent. We have learned things about Zika that we did not know about their other related flaviviruses. And this relates to the specific clinical syndromes and also some of the patterns as to what tissues it goes to and what is the fate of the virus. And so the new syndromes that we think of with Zika virus that we don't see necessarily with dengue virus, with yellow fever virus, with West Nile virus, close relatives in the family, is that this virus can be transmitted, at least in some cases, in utero, meaning from mother to fetus, and this has certainly significant complications, which I'm going to list in a moment. This can be transmitted sexually. It has now been shown male to female, male to male, and there was a recent report this past week of female to male, although it still requires further documentation. It was a single case. It can be transmitted by blood, in theory, and in addition to its primary transmission mode, which is felt to be mosquito transmission, with the Aedes aegypti mosquitoes. This virus can cause Guillain-Barré syndrome, I alluded to that, where you have a sensory polyneuropathy, an ascending, you have weakness and numbness, and it can go up from your from your toes all the way to your arms, to also, if it gets serious, into your breathing, and you can actually require ventilation in the intensive care unit. In utero, this is one of the findings that certainly has stirred a lot of the press, which is microcephaly, or essentially a small head. And what can happen is the virus infects the brain of the developing fetus, and this leads to death of the neural progenitor cells. Those are the cells which are required to develop into neurons. And you get what's called cortical thinning, meaning the cerebral cortex, which is the area of the brain that controls a number of important functions, does not have the normal volume of neurons in it because they're being killed off as the progenitor cells. And then if the fetus is born, they are susceptible to significant neurodevelopmental complications associated with it. It can also cause meningitis and encephalitis, although rarely, unlike West Nile virus, which does this relatively frequently, especially in the elderly and those that are immune compromised, Zika can do this, but there are only a few cases in adults of meningitis and encephalitis. Another aspect of problems in utero is intrauterine growth retardation or intrauterine growth restriction. And what this really is that the virus, and I'll show some data on this, infects the cells of the placenta. And when it does that, it causes injury to the placenta. And if the placenta is not functioning optimally, blood flow does not go to the fetus. And so the fetus is not getting as the adequate amount of nutrition, and so it doesn't grow as quickly as it should. And of course, having a very small size means having problems in development in all aspects of not only neurodevelopment, but other aspects as well. We've also seen the virus targeting the eyes of newborns and causing blindness or other complications. And then one of the major issues that we're dealing with now is persistence. So we normally think about flaviviruses as viruses that you get an infection, you clear the infection, hopefully you live for most of the flaviviruses, and then you're done with it and you're immune. But what we've learned with Zika, which is a little unusual, is that it seems to persist in infectious form in multiple bodily fluids, including semen, urine, and saliva. We do not know fully the significance of these in the context of transmission, although it's clear that you can get male to female and male to male transmission through semen. So there are urgent needs to study an emergent virus. And part of the problem is that the virus before 2007, of course, really was off the radar completely. Really wasn't until 2013 when we had the Guillain-Barré in French Polynesia. And obviously, it didn't really blow up until it came into South America in Brazil in 2015. And so we didn't really have many things ongoing in the research portfolio around the world because people were studying other viruses or other pathogens that cause severe disease, HIV, tuberculosis, dengue, malaria, things that were causing great harm to populations all over the world. So the important things to study are animal models, and these are important to begin to address questions about causality. What is it actually causing and what is it not causing? Can we use animal models to create systems where we could then rapidly test vaccines or therapeutics so we could translate them? And can we understand some of the fundamental biology associated with Zika virus? Understanding Guillain-Barré, this is still a major question. We don't really have any models for it. Maternal transmission, why Zika virus? Why does Zika virus infect the placenta and go into the fetus, but other viruses don't do it in this family? That's not to say that other viruses don't do it. Cytomegalovirus is another virus that does this not infrequently. And so we have seen many of the same similar syndromes associated with Zika that we saw with cytomegalovirus or with rubella virus years ago. And understanding what happens in the context of human disease longitudinally is important. Why do some people develop disease and others not? Is there a genetic basis for it? Is there an immunologic basis for it? Is there something associated with the viral strains? Is it something associated with that person's cells? How can we begin to learn about these questions? So one of the things that have been done more recently by groups in Brazil, and of course the Brazilian scientists have actually been leading many of the clinical studies because they have populations that they've been following, and I should point out that they've been doing an outstanding job of actually getting the information out to the rest of the world. And this was a study that was published in the New England Journal earlier this year, which was rather remarkable. And they had a cohort of patients that they were following for dengue. And then Zika hit, and they rapidly were able to get approval to study Zika virus through their institutional review board. And they followed pregnant women. And if pregnant women developed a rash, they enrolled them in the study. And then they tested them for Zika virus using nucleic acid testing modalities, and that is a highly sensitive, highly specific way to test during the acute phase. 72% of the pregnant women who had a rash had Zika virus, which is an extraordinary number. But remember, they were in the middle of a Zika epidemic. And then they followed them, and they followed the 72% who had Zika virus and the 28% who didn't have Zika virus, and they did serial ultrasounds and then followed for outcome. And what they found was that 29% of the women who were Zika positive had abnormalities throughout their pregnancy that were detected by ultrasound, including microcephaly, placental insufficiency, intrauterine growth retardation, and other clinical findings, whereas none of the other women who were in the other group had any of these. And this has led people to wonder about what is the frequency with which Zika causes disease in pregnant women. Now, these were only pregnant women who had a rash and a fever, so therefore they were a subset that were clinically symptomatic. The numbers that we have heard, although without full documentation, is probably in the range somewhere between 0.1% and 1% of pregnant women who get infected, whether they have symptoms or not, are likely to have some complications. But those numbers are relatively loose and still require further study with larger scale analysis. So there are three hypotheses, I should say. There are at least three hypotheses, these are three of my hypotheses, as to why Zika virus has caused new clinical syndromes. Remember, it didn't seem to be doing this when it was in Africa. Now, the fourth hypothesis really is the null hypothesis, which I'll mention. So one of them is that Zika virus has evolved at the sequence level, meaning these are RNA viruses. RNA viruses, every cycle that they replicate, they have a non-faithful RNA polymerase. And what that means is that they have errors that get put into the genome. On average, one error per genome if it's an 11,000 base pair genome. And that means every copy of the genome that it makes probably has, on average, an error in it. And therefore, you can get rapid evolution of these viruses. Now, some of this is mitigated by the fact that the virus has to go between multiple hosts. It goes from a human to a mosquito, so it can't change too much, because if it changed so much for a human, it might go to the mosquito and be dead. And if it changed for the mosquito, it might go to the human and be dead. So there is some control measure for these viruses, but nonetheless, you can get evolution. And the fact is, you only need one change to actually alter a phenotype. As an example, another virus that we work on in my laboratory, Chikungunya virus, had a single amino acid change in its envelope protein that changed its ability to replicate in a effectively in a different mosquito vector. It shifted from Aedes aegypti to Aedes albopictus, and that led to explosive epidemics in Africa and the Indian subcontinent in 2006. So a single amino acid can matter. So this is one hypothesis. The second is the virus moved into South America, and it was different. The people there were different than they are in Africa genetically, or their susceptibility to viruses. And there's some genetic factor, which we don't understand, some unique aspect of moving into a new population whereby that population is more sensitive to infection. This could still be true, although we do not have data on this yet. And the other is that the immune background is different, meaning that if you move into an area where people have been exposed to other flaviviruses like dengue, so dengue is hyper-endemic in Brazil, in Central America, in Mexico, in Puerto Rico, that immunity to dengue could affect the outcome of Zika disease. Now, this is a hypothesis. We don't know. Certainly, it warrants further study. And the fourth one really is the null one. The virus hasn't changed at all. This was occurring all along in Africa, but it was under the radar. For some reason, there was less infection that was occurring. Either it was just not diagnosed, or something changed in the mosquito. It had nothing to do with the human biology. And really, these cases of severe clinical syndromes actually were occurring. We don't know if that's correct either, but those are questions that need to be answered. So how can we address the Zika virus epidemic? Well, there are a few things we can do. We can do this, spray, and we do this. Whether you could argue whether this is a good idea or a bad idea. Well, from an environmental perspective, it's not a great idea. But if you have a Zika epidemic at your doorstep and you're at risk, this does something. It's not very efficient, but it can have some efficacy. We do this for West Nile virus. Many of you may remember in New York in the original 1999 outbreak, they were spraying from helicopters. It was sort of like Apocalypse Now. There are other measures for controlling mosquito, abatement programs, larvicides, other things that may be more efficient, and also newer interventions using genetic controls, either by changing the mosquito's genetic makeup or introducing bacteria that are commensal bacteria, or introducing sterile males into the population, which can mitigate the amount of a virus that is actually spread. And all of these things are being under study and being evaluated. Arguably, you could say, well, I'm going to less worry about the vector and focus on the host, meaning the mammalian host, meaning us. And this is what happens in the laboratory, is can we develop vaccines which are very efficient to put into a population to control the amount of disease, but also to prevent the spread, because the virus, Zika virus, goes primarily between mosquito, human, mosquito, human, without another major reservoir. In Africa, in the jungles, the monkeys may be a reservoir. But in most urban areas, there are not a lot of monkeys running around. And so if you were able to reduce the number of population that was actually susceptible because you gave them a vaccine, you would prevent epidemics because the mosquito would not be able to go back and forth, the virus would not be able to go back and forth between the mosquito and the host. And of course, development of antivirals, if somebody did get infected, could we actually treat them or could we prevent it? For example, if you had a great drug, could you give it at the beginning of pregnancy and just have it being given throughout pregnancy? So that's done with HIV to prevent HIV transmission. It's done with malaria in certain cases. So there are drugs that can be administered either at different phases of pregnancy or throughout pregnancy. However, we have no antivirals right now against any flavivirus or Zika virus. So this is an active area of research. I mean, the other option, of course, it's not great. This is a cartoon that I stole. And basically, you can hide. I mean, it's not really a great idea, but for example, here in this cartoon, and I'm sure many of you have done this, either you've gone camping or you've been in your house where there hasn't been air conditioning, and you just hide under the covers, and you can avoid the mosquito, but there are consequences of it. For example, the temperature underneath there gets really well over 100 degrees and it becomes intolerable. So hiding is probably not a great option. So what should we do? Well, should we fund for this? Well, this is a problem. Zika has become politicized. It's not just a problem for people who are getting infected. It's not just a global public health problem, which is a big enough problem as it is, but it is politicized in the United States. Certainly, we were hoping to have funding. President Obama had suggested that $1.9 billion, which remember would cover mosquito control measures, epidemiology, research, vaccine development, providing support, clinical study support throughout the world. And then there were, of course, other plans by both the Democrats and the Republicans, and ultimately nothing got passed. And they went home for recess or summer break with no funding plan. And of course, as a researcher, this is disappointing, and I'm sure the public is disappointed, but this is the political situation that we live in currently. Okay. Without going more into politics. So what do we do in the laboratory? So my laboratory studies emerging diseases, and we have a number of major goals. And I'll show you a little bit about how we address that in a moment. We're interested in studying mechanisms of viral pathogenesis. What does that mean? That means, how does the virus actually cause the disease that it causes? So from the time, and we're doing this, my laboratory does this in the mammalian host, using small animal models, but trying to understand disease in humans. Once the virus gets introduced into that host, what are the steps that actually have to occur to allow some form of severe disease, whether that severe disease is in utero transmission, whether that disease is eye disease, whether that disease is virus going to the brain? How does the immune system try to stop it? What are the aspects of immunity that are fundamental in restricting it? And then what is the virus doing to avoid it? Because really, in order to have pathogenesis, meaning in order to have disease, the virus is being targeted by the immune system, and it has to target back and avoid the immune system. And it can do it one of two ways, philosophically. One is it can just avoid it, hide, if you will, cloak itself in some way that it becomes relatively invisible, and they do that to some degree. The virus is a conundrum in the immune system of trying to distinguish self from non-self. You don't want to attack yourself. That's how you get autoimmune disease. You want to attack foreign. However, the virus senses in some way its evolved understanding of foreignness, and it tries to actually make it look like self, so it doesn't get attacked. So that's one way. And the other way the virus is, the virus actually directly subverts the immune system, antagonizes the immune system in a very active process. And of course, in my laboratory, we try to synthesize this information for trying to generate new strategies for generating therapeutics or vaccines. And so among the viruses that we've studied in my laboratory are dengue, West Nile, chikungunya. There's a virus in Brazil called Oropouche virus, Venezuelan equine encephalitis virus, Japanese encephalitis virus, lacrosse encephalitis virus, Mayaro virus, which causes arthritis, and Zika virus. We started Zika virus in June of 2015. And as a faculty member, one has to make decisions. When is it time to start to work on something? when is it time, do you think that something is going to emerge or not? And there is, because you have to be able to dedicate resources and divert people working on projects. And that is not an easy decision. And I don't have a crystal ball, and none of the other scientists do either. So you have to sort of gauge what's going on and then be able to make some good guesses based on this. And in my career, I guessed that West Nile was going to be a problem, and certainly it was. And we studied West Nile for a very long time. And we did the same with chikungunya virus, and we switched over last year to studying many people in the lab studying Zika virus. And why did we do that? One of the reasons is before 2016, nobody studied Zika virus, essentially. There were very few people studying it. So I realized that there was an opportunity to actually study something that people weren't studying and actually make progress ahead of the game, which could actually be useful to the field, not just the scientific field, but the greater global public health field. And the reason why is because I read the literature on what was known about Zika virus. And so last June or so, when I started to think about studying it, or May, I looked in the literature, and in my laboratory, we were very much interested in modeling virus infection in animals so that we can actually think about understanding the genetics of host interactions with the immune system. But there really wasn't much known in animals because the only two animal studies were these. This is it. This was the literature. 1947, when they discovered the virus, I told you they put the monkeys up in the canopy, took the one febrile monkey, passaged it through a mouse, and that gave us the prototype Ugandan isolate called MR766. And then somebody dug this one out of the freezer somehow in 1976 and put it in some baby mice and some adult mice, and that was it. There was no other literature on this virus in animals. And so we started to study it. And we wanted to ask the question of how does this virus transmit in utero? Why is Zika different than other flaviviruses? And what is the process by which Zika goes from the mother to the developing fetus? And wanted to establish a model. And so I'm not going to go into all of the details, but we identified some mice. We had to sort of genetically manipulate them a little bit so the mother would get infected sufficiently. We infected the mother, and then we followed the infection in utero in the fetuses, or we waited until the animals were born and evaluated them. And we looked at survival, at pathology, at how much virus was replicating, what were the constituents of the immune response, and what was happening to the mother, to the fetus, and to the neonate. And here, the first major experiment that we saw was that if we infected an animal where we had to compromise its immune system so the placenta could get infected, and then Zika got into the placenta, what happened if you infected early enough in the first trimester, you basically caused very severe placental insufficiency, which I'll show, and this led to fetal demise. And what has been seen in humans in some cases is that Zika virus infection in utero can cause spontaneous miscarriage. And this is essentially spontaneous miscarriage in a mouse model of it. And you can see here that the embryo is, the fetus is significantly smaller than it would be normally in a wild type uninfected or an uninfected animal or an infected animal which has a normal immune system. And here it's much smaller, and this ultimately leads to resorption. And here, if you go a little bit later, so now we're infecting in the second trimester. This is the animals that are uninfected. You can see the large size. And here, now harvesting at 18.5, which is in the third trimester, you can see the animals that were infected with Zika are much smaller. And this recapitulates, to some extent, what is seen in subsets of humans that actually get infection during pregnancy. They get intrauterine growth retardation, and they get small fetuses, in addition to the microcephaly that's seen, which is isolated small head. So it's different, but they also get this syndrome as well. And so why does this occur? And so we did studies to look at this. I'm not going to go into great detail except to say the virus can infect the trophoblast cells. So in the placenta is made up of a number of different cells. There is a key cell called the trophoblast cell, which brings in the nutrition from the mother, from the mother's blood, across into the fetus. It also has a role in protecting the fetus from foreign organisms, but unfortunately in this case, Zika virus is able to infect the trophoblasts, the cells that are the barrier themselves, the cells that are actually bringing in the nutrients, and it's also able to infect the endothelial cells. These are the cells that line the fetal bloodstream. So what happens is the virus can infect the placental cells from the mother, the blood goes into the placenta, the cells get infected, they then pass off the virus to the endothelial cells, and then it can get into the brain. And in addition to that, it can damage the placenta. And so this may be a little bit hard to see here, but you can see this is a normal looking placenta, and you can see there's a lot of red blood cells here, and these are fetal erythrocytes, and this is evidence of stress. And more significantly, these are stained here with different markers, one for cytokeratin and one for vimentin. These are proteins that are in the placenta that are indicative of a healthy placenta, large numbers of cells, good matrix context. And here, as we infect, you can see we lose the staining here. And when this staining is gone, that means the barrier is breaking down. It no longer has the same integrity, and therefore, it's not able to transmit all of the nutrients, but in addition, it's causing significant stress to the developing fetus. And this ultimately, in the most severe cases, of course, leads to miscarriage. So if we think about this from a cartoon perspective, the virus is in the mother, and then gets into the bloodstream of the mother, and then it gets dumped into this space here, which is the cells, the placental cells of the fetus, and it gets picked up by these cells. The particular cells are not important for this audience today, but some of the cells here, which are the fetal placental cells, they actually get directly infected. Then they pass off to another layer of fetal placental cells here, called the syncytial trophoblasts, which are the barrier cells. And then they infect the fetal endothelial cells, and then the virus goes in the fetal circulation and then can get to the brain. And when it gets to the brain, there's a problem, because the brain is not particularly immune protected, and certainly not in a fetus, and causes cell death in the brain. And it's a little hard to see here, but there are red dots, and these red dots are evidence of dying neurons or neuroprogenitor cells. And so if there are a large number of neuroprogenitor cells that are dying at any given time, then the fetus is going to have complications of that developmentally, as well as have microcephaly. And so that's what's occurring. In addition to that, it affects other areas. So this is an area in the eye, and we know that Zika virus can target the eye. And during those who are newborns can have problems with it, as well as in utero after if they die. People have done analysis of it, and this is an animal model of it in mice. And what we've been able to show is that Zika virus is able to infect the retinal cells here, as well as the optic nerve. So this is critical. These cells actually will go on to probably die at some frequency, and of course this would compromise vision in some way or another. So what can we do about it from the laboratory perspective? Well, my laboratory is a viral immunology laboratory, and so we're very much interested in understanding B and T cell responses, both at the basic fundamental level, how do they actually target the virus, which I'll show a little bit of data, but also, can we translate that information to develop therapeutics or inform the development of vaccines? And so the idea here is, can we generate antibodies, either mouse antibodies or human antibodies, to learn about the virus? These antibodies react with Zika virus proteins. And then can we study the effectiveness of these antibodies in preventing disease first in mice, and then perhaps ultimately in humans, either directly or by informing the development of vaccines? In order to understand where the antibodies actually bind, we need some structural information. I alluded to the fact that we have a cryo-electron microscopic reconstruction of this virus at very high resolution, 3.8 angstroms. We also have high resolution structures of the envelope protein, which sits on this. There are 180 copies of this envelope protein, which sit on the surface of this viral particle. And these sit as a dimer, a head-to-tail dimer. There's one here and one here, and they sit opposite one another. And understanding where the antibodies bind that are the most protective antibodies can actually allow you to say, can I make a minimal region, what we call a minimal epitope, which then could be used to induce strong, robust, and protective antibody responses. And so we did that. We identified neutralizing antibodies, and we did X-ray crystallography with my colleague David Fremont at Washington University, and we identified a series of regions of the molecule of the envelope protein which these strongly neutralizing antibodies actually bound. One of them we call the lateral ridge epitope here. It's in purple here. And what's interesting is that this area, which I'm just going to highlight as the purple part, is analogous to other highly neutralizing antibodies that we generated in the past against West Nile virus. and against dengue virus. So the same strategy the immune system uses to target the virus is one that it uses to target all members of the viral family. Unfortunately, the sequences are too different, so that one antibody that we may have generated years ago against West Nile, which is very protective, does not work against Zika. But the region is, and that region can inform vaccine development. And in fact, we can show that these antibodies are protective. If you administer them to mice, you can decrease viremia, you can improve weight gain. If you give them an irrelevant antibody, in this case one we generated against chikungunya virus, you get a significant weight loss. And here this is survival analysis. So this is the percent survival. And if you give them an irrelevant antibody or no antibody, in this case for the animal model that we're using, all of the animals die, or most of them, 90% of them. However, if we give them the antibody that we generated, which is a Zika-specific antibody, which binds this region of the molecule, we can completely protect the antibodies and also treat the animals or protect the animals from infection. So let me summarize our studies that we've done, and then I'll come to a conclusion about where things have to go. So our laboratory studies, we have developed in my lab new mouse models of Zika pathogenesis. We've done multiple ones, adult models, because we're interested in what happens in adults. And in those models, for example, we've been studying persistence of virus in the testes. How long is it infectious? As one example. 1-week-old wild-type mice, what happens to newborn animals? How are they infected? What are the consequences? And then pregnancy infections and in utero transmissions. And all of these models can inform different aspects of disease that we see in humans. If we focus on the in utero transmission model, we've shown transplacental transmission. So the question was, how did the virus get to the fetus? So we've now shown the virus infects the trophoblasts, then moves to the endothelial cells, and then goes into the bloodstream, and then infects the neuroprogenitor cells. So that's the path that it takes. And the virus can then spread to the fetal brain and cause cell death. And you also see this intrauterine growth restriction, and that's due to placental insufficiency because the trophoblasts themselves are dying once they get infected. And we've also generated new panels of antibodies against different epitopes or different regions of the molecules, and we've shown these are protective against the lethal infection model, and now this can be used in the context of translation. But there's still many other questions. And so the field is trying to translate these basic discoveries to answer still many important questions, but then to apply them to develop remedies and things that can mitigate human disease. For example, can we figure out ways to stop sexual transmission? Can we figure out ways to prevent Guillain-Barré syndrome? Can we figure out ways to understand pregnancy transmission and mitigate that as well? And then there are a number of different factors we need to understand about the relationship between dengue and Zika virus and whether immunity to one has an effect on the other or not. So there are still many questions. What happens in the eye? Are there other organs that are still infected? We still don't know. So the path to translation, and what we mean by translation is translating basic discoveries, taking discoveries out of the lab very rapidly and putting them in clinical studies to try to at least have a rapid path, an expedited path, to actually prevent human suffering. And so we're using these models to study the biology of how it causes disease, but also to test novel vaccines. We are in my laboratory already testing several vaccines. We are already testing novel therapeutics using the mouse models. Others are doing this with non-human primate models. And ultimately, these have to go into humans to be tested. And we're using our monoclonal antibodies not only for vaccines and therapeutics, but also as diagnostic reagents and to inform vaccine targets. So I'd like to stop there and just acknowledge, you can barely see it because of the colors, a number of people in my laboratory that have been dedicated much of their time over the past year to really studying Zika virus from the other projects that they were working on. Also my close collaborator, David Freeman, who's a structural biologist, and we have a number of other people at WashU from an interdisciplinary group ranging from neuroscientists, ophthalmologists, people who study placental immunology, obstetrics and gynecology, because this virus crosses a number of scientific disciplines and requires a community of scientists with different specialties to make rapid advancement. We also work with our NIH colleagues, Ted Pearson here, my colleague who studies human antibodies, Jim Crow at Vanderbilt University, and our laboratory is funded by the National Institute of Health. And I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Hi, Thank you for the talk. That was great. My name's Melissa Martin. I'm a joint fellow here at the Academy and Strategic Alliances here at ASM. I have a couple of questions. The first is, 2 days ago there was an article in the New York Times that Colombia had declared that their Zika epidemic was over. So I didn't know what your thoughts on that were, and if you think that maybe this Zika will start burning itself out as populations are becoming immune. And then the second question was, it's so interesting that we've known about Zika for 6 years and now there's this epidemic, like you were saying. And if we're thinking about the evolution of it, has anyone sequenced any of the early strains and compared them to the strains that we have now?
Okay, so I'll answer the first question about Colombia and then the second one afterwards. The first question is whether Zika has basically burned itself out in Colombia and there's no longer an epidemic problem. I think that certainly there are, in South America, as there are in North America, there are cycles related to the seasons as to whether mosquitoes are infected and mosquitoes are circulating. My suspicion is they're probably at a low in Colombia because of the time of year that it is. However, it is still present in South America and it moves globally. People travel every day and the mosquito vector is there. So until such time that the majority of people are immune, there's always going to be a susceptible population. And so my suspicion is that the number of cases have dropped significantly, but it will probably recrudesce unless immunity has really reached a certain point where most of the population has already been infected at that stage. And I don't know the answer to that. And unless they can do epidemiologic analysis to say that, seroprevalence analysis, you're not going to know. Part of the problem is it's very difficult to do seroprevalence analysis right now because we do not have a diagnostic test at the serologic level that adequately distinguishes it from dengue. So I would say that it's possible that it is significantly lower. I'm a little circumspect about complete elimination given what we know about other parts of South America. Now, to address your second question about sequencing, many of the isolates have been sequenced. They vary. There's about 2 to 5% variation depending upon the lineage, the African lineage, the Asian lineage, and the American lineage. What we don't know is whether that sequence difference actually contributes to any of the clinical phenotypes. That is the question. That is a big question in the laboratory. I will say in mice, and one has a limitation, it's a mouse, not a human, that the strains from Africa are equally able to cause the same disease phenotypes that we see as the ones in Asia and in America. There is very little distinction between them. They all are able to do it, with the exception of the one original strain, and that strain was passaged over 100 times before it was used, so it adapted in some weird way. But outside of that single strain, almost all of the strains are able to behave relatively similarly. That said, we don't know in humans if that is the case or not, or whether there are other factors that are modulating disease irrespective of the actual sequence of the strain. Right. The sequences have been generated. There are infectious clones of the viruses. Now we can introduce mutations back and forth. We will know those answers soon. We don't yet.
And then just to follow up, are there any GWAS studies going on with the human host between?
Yeah, so they have started now. There's a, it's called the ZIP strain, the Zika in pregnancy strain, where they're going to follow thousands of people. As part of that study, they're doing immune profiling, genetic profiling, and there also are studies in Brazil that are ongoing. It is still too early to know exactly if there are single loci that are associated with this. It's going to take significant time.
I'm Barbara Goldman. I'm the director of journals here at ASM. And I was interested in the different outcomes depending on how early in pregnancy the mother is infected. And I wondered if differences in miscarriage rates could affect why it was under the radar in Africa.
So the question there's really two parts to it. One is are there differences at the stage of pregnancy associated with the clinical disease you see? And then because miscarriage occurs in pregnancy at a certain amount anyway, it could have been missed in terms of if it was occurring at a low level. So the first part is that we still are trying to understand the different types of disease that are occurring in the different stages. Clearly, in the beginning, I think it was thought that most of the disease was probably occurring during the first trimester. What has come out of the Brazilian study, at least the prospective study, is you can still get severe disease even in the third trimester, although most of the severe outcomes seem to be associated with first and second, early second trimester. But it is not only those, and certainly there are some bad outcomes that occur in third trimester. Whether that's placental damage or whether that's damage to the fetus directly, still not unclear. In terms of the miscarriage rate, I think that one possibility is if this is a very infrequent occurrence, and it is relatively, if you think about it, if the numbers are really 0.1 to 1%, and the denominator is low, meaning that the epidemic, force of the epidemic, instead of infecting millions in South America, you're infecting thousands in Africa, then the number of pregnant women who are actually going to have a bad outcome is actually relatively small. And of course, miscarriage, there are a lot of reasons for miscarriage. Many of them are actually protective reasons, meaning that the number of chromosomes is incorrect, and so the body is actually saying that I can't develop, and therefore there's a spontaneous miscarriage that occurs. So it could have gone unnoticed, and this is one of the questions that they're trying to answer. Remember that even in French Polynesia in 2013, nobody reported microcephaly. However, when they went back retrospectively, they had microcephaly. And it was only on retrospective analysis, when they did full-scale further epidemiologic analysis and interviews, that they were able to realize there was an increased incidence of microcephaly. So they weren't looking for it. So it's certainly possible that it was occurring in Africa, although we don't know.
All right, we've got a question from Twitter, Danya Myers. She's wondering, are you checking to see if chikungunya immunity is either protective or in some other way affects susceptibility?
So chikungunya is an alpha virus, a member of the Togaviridae family. It is very, very distantly related. And antibodies to alpha viruses do not cross-react with flaviviruses. And so the likelihood is very low that there would be a significant interaction. It would also be, if you had any other intercurrent illness with another pathogen, would the antibodies or immunity interact? Now, that said, immunity can interact in another way. For example, if you get infected with one thing and you're compromised because you have an infection or you have another clinical condition, you may be more susceptible to another viral infection. We all know that once you're sick, you can get more sick with something else. And that's not necessarily direct specific immunity, that's non-specific immunity, meaning that there's an immune system response, and that may affect your ability of your other blood cells to respond. But chikungunya is far enough away that I don't think that there's, and we haven't seen in the lab, that there's any evidence that direct specific immunity of chikungunya virus would impact this. In contrast, of course, dengue virus immunity is far more related, and therefore there is still this outstanding question of, do people with pre-existing dengue virus or even intercurrent dengue virus get more severe Zika disease, and this is not known yet.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Pierre Cartier. I'm a population health professional, and I had a question about salivary diagnostics for Zika virus infection. You mentioned that it can be spread through saliva, so wondering if there's any research on that front. Then I also had a question about antigenic commonality between the dengue virus and the Zika virus, and whether individuals who are infected with dengue at some point may also have some protection to the Zika virus.
Dengue may have some, what was the last point?
Protection against the Zika virus.
Yeah. Okay. So let me answer the first part. So Zika is present in saliva. I'm not aware of it being documented in transmission. I certainly have seen evidence of infectious virus in saliva, and certainly they're now using it to follow viral RNA because it's a non-invasive test. And virus goes away in the bloodstream very rapidly, but it has been now shown that virus persists longer, or viral RNA persists in saliva. So it is a more sensitive test further out after the acute infection. Although I'm not aware that it's actually infectious. That's not to say it couldn't be, but I don't think that it's been proven so yet. But there is infectious virus, so in theory it could be. Whether it is or not, I don't know. Are there people studying it? Yes, there are. Certainly in the clinical trials in Brazil and South America, they are following saliva, both for how long the RNA and the infectious virus lasts in those saliva, in those bodily fluids, sorry. However, in the basic research studies, people have found it, but I don't think anybody's actually doing experiments yet with it to determine the infectivity of it and its ability to transmit under different conditions. Now, the second question was related to dengue and whether dengue immunity could be protective. And so it is possible. So there was a paper that was published recently by Felix Ray's group at the Pasteur and Gavin Screeton's group at Oxford, and another paper by Ralph Barrick's group at University of North Carolina. And in it, they described a class of anti-dengue antibodies, which are called EDE antibodies. The name is not important, except that they map to a certain region on dengue. Those are highly protective dengue antibodies. And they cross-reacted to Zika, and they were able to protect against disease in mice. So it is possible. However, many people's serum did not seem to have adequate amounts of those antibodies to actually do that. But they were able to find monoclonal antibodies by looking for them. But the question is that whether that actually happens in reality, we don't know yet.
Thank you.
I'd also like to thank the staff that were very helpful in putting all of this together, Chris Kondian, Catherine Lontick, Dan Peniston, and Virginia Dolan. And so now, this concludes this portion, but we'd really like, as I mentioned at the onset, to have you join us for a reception in the other room, 101 A and B, so, and for further discussion. Thank you so much.
Once you're in the BSL-4 space, the only way you can get out is to go through a chemical shock.
It's an unusual room, never seen anything like this.
Anybody who has access to this facility first has to go through an IR scan.
So the HEPA filters filter the air coming out of the facility, and that will remove bacteria, viruses, anything that might constitute any kind of risk, right?
Remember, this building is basically a second building inside the main building.